Luke chapter 5, verses 27 and 29. Amen. After these things, he went out and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax office. And he said unto him, follow me. Verse 28. So Levi, he left all, rose up and followed him. 29. Then Levi gave a great feast in his own house, and there were a great number of tax collectors and others who sat down with them. And others that sat down with him. You might be seated in the presence of the Lord. Thank you, Lord. I don't make an apology for being excited. I've been excited for almost 39 years. What brought this time into my life? Meeting him, grace. So we're going to talk about Matthew, and I call this A Table of Grace. I want to title this message, A Table of Grace. Again, I wanted to call it Matthew's Party, but actually it's about grace. We're talking about grace in this place, and we're singing about grace in this place. We teach about grace, so let's walk and talk about grace. So again, and we saw that in the scripture. Now, it has been said, just a little background, it's been said that you can tell a man by the company he keeps. That you can tell a man by the company he keeps. Somebody said, birds of the feather flock together. Who you are with, it tells who you are. So if you can tell a man by the company he keeps, I'm talking, we have people that gather together for a common reason. The baseball players play baseball, they hang together. The football players play football, they play together. The musicians hang together, they play music. The preachers get together, so they have something in common. How about Jesus? What did he have in common? I want us to turn real quick to Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. This is who Jesus really, in reality, was and is today. In Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, we're going to see how Jesus, here on this scripture, he unveils the recruiting policy for people for his kingdom. Before he goes, I mean, he already preached, already healed people, but here on Luke 4, 18 and 19, he unveils, he reveals, I call it a recruiting policy for people, for his kingdom. We may have the scripture, please. And you know the scripture. It says, Jesus walked into the place, into the temple. The Bible says it was given unto him the scrolls of Isaiah. And he opened up the book and he began to read actually about himself. Speaking of what Isaiah said in chapter 61, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty, number 19, please, those who are oppressed. Here, Jesus is setting like a recruiting policy on the people that he's going to begin to recruit for his kingdom. And I believe most of us, we're in one of those categories, if not all of us, were in those categories. But when Jesus says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach, to open the blind's eyes and to the oppressed and all that, Jesus began to recruit people for his kingdom. And like I said, somehow I think this was like a recruiting policy. Jesus says, according to Luke 4, 18, 19, this is what I'm going to do once I get out of the temple, once I read the scriptures. And it says that when recruiting policy was in place, Jesus began to recruit people for his kingdom. He walks around with authority and with compassion, looking for people. Did you know God is always looking for people? God is not looking at a clique, a denomination, or necessarily a church. He's looking for people. I believe his heartbeat says, people, people, people. Because we are his creation. But here Jesus walking around with authority and power and compassion, looking for people, and he would tell to them, I want you, I want you, and I want you. The first people that he collected to be his disciples, he recruited. If you know chapter 5, we turn there. Chapter 5, verses 8 and 11. You know Peter. Peter was a fisherman. And he's fishing by the seashore in chapter 5. And he begins to, Jesus comes to him. But the story tells us that Peter and the guys had not caught anything yet. They fish all night and nothing was caught from the net. Until Jesus appeared on the scene and says, Peter, push a little farther into the water and cast your net down for a humongous catch of fish. So Peter, being obedient, did that. And in verses 8 and 11 of chapter 5, if we have it there, can we put it out there? When Simon Peter saw this, the great catch, he fell down at Jesus' feet, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. Verse 9. For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of the fish which they had taken. Verse 10. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, Do not be afraid. From now on, you will catch men. Verse 11. So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook everything and began to follow Jesus. So here's the story begins to unravel. Who are these people that Jesus is recruiting for his kingdom? First, he goes to the fisherman, Simon. And all of a sudden, Simon, who was a fisherman, Simon was not a religious person. Simon Peter, which was changed the name later, he was not somebody that was a very religious. He was not educated in the Bible. He didn't know the Old Testament, perhaps, but he was a radical individual. He says, I was created to fish. I'm going to fish. And later on, after Simon is converted to Peter, Simon was a radical individual. He was the kind of person they will say what he was on his mouth to say it. And many times, he would stick his foot in his mouth. Somebody called him the one-legged disciple. Because he always spoke what was in his heart. So here we see Peter, which was an ordinary fisherman. He was not a rabbi. He had never attended Sunday school. He didn't teach Sunday school. But he was a mere ordinary fisherman. But Jesus says, I want you, Peter. And I'm going to change the name too. You shall be known as the Rock. Peter, Simon, I want you. So all of a sudden, Peter and his fishing buddies, James and John, gave it all up. I believe those three guys were the three best fishermen in the village. But when Jesus came and he appeared to them, the three began to follow him. Can you see the fishing market shut down for a day? Where is the fish? It says, I don't know, Simon, John, and James, they took off with this guy. But why? I don't know, but they're following him. So here is Jesus walking around with three ex-fishermen to build his kingdom. Those he would call to be in his kingdom. So they're walking around, Jesus and three ex-fishermen. Who's next? Who would Jesus go to next? You expect Jesus' recruitment would be to go to the synagogue and get the best at the top of the... No, he goes around. And the next person he comes in touch with was a leper in verses 12 and 13. If you have the scriptures, will you put him out there? And it happened when he was in a certain city that behold, a man who was full of leprosy saw Jesus. And he fell on his face and implored him, saying, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. Verse 13. Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing, be cleansed. And immediately the leprosy left the man. So Jesus is walking around with three ex-fishermen. Now he encounters a leper. Come on, Jesus, you can do better than that. Why don't you go to Second Baptist, First Presbyterian, or even Grace Point and get somebody that knows the Bible? He goes to a leper. See, if Peter, I believe he was known. Peter was known as an outcast. Peter was what I call an outsider, establishment outsider. He was radical. He was establishment, but he was an outsider because he was not with Jesus. Now he is with Jesus. Now Jesus comes to the leper. Now understand, in the Old Testament, when people have leprosy, they were shunned away by the regular folk. Why? Because if somebody had leprosy, it meant that somebody had sinned in their family. Therefore, nobody will touch him. And if you read the Old Testament, when a leper would come to town or to the marketplace, before he walked into the marketplace, he had to say, unclean, unclean. And in some instances, he will carry a bell ringing it, unclean, unclean, so people will part away so he can go through because nobody wanted to touch him. He was a leper. But the Bible says, he said, Jesus, if you're willing, do you know God is willing? And I said, God, if you will, can you heal me? Yes, I will. Jesus, yes, I will. And the Bible says nobody would touch a leper, not even the rabbis, not even the preachers, but Jesus touched him. Oh, there's grace, my brother. My sister, there's grace when you can be touched by God himself, when nobody will touch you, when nobody give you the time of the day, Jesus says, come here. And I don't believe he just touched him like this. Maybe I'm exaggerating, but that's okay. I believe when he said he touched him, I believe he hugged him. There's a leper that never been hugged by nobody. There's a leper that never been hugged and embraced by his family. Jesus says, come here. He touched him. My question is to me, am I touchable by somebody? I'm full of grace, full of mercy, but am I touchable? And I'll tell you a quick little story from many, many years. I would go to Salvation Army up on North Side, Harbor Light Salvation Army place. And I'll tell you what, it was difficult. You hear me say this story, but I say it because once the life of God comes into your being, you don't care who's touching you and you don't care who you touch. The preacher is preaching the gospel, and I knew he was going to give an altar call for the men to come to salvation, to know Christ or whatever, and I'm there to help. But my responsibility was when the altar came and people came, the men came out front, my responsibility was to step down from where I was on the platform and pray for these guys and hug him and lead him to the Lord, giving the scriptures. I remember this one time, this guy sitting in the back, he looked mean. He was about 6'11", humongous. He had beard this long. His eyes were red, and he looked like he had vomit on his beard. I'm sorry, I'm telling you the truth, okay? And I said, oh, God, not him. You see, you can pick and choose, but God is the one that does the ultimate calling. You can have an altar call. You can try to lead somebody to the Lord, but God already knows the heart of the person, regardless of what he or she looks like. And I say, oh, God, not him. I'm honest, and I begin to pray under my tongue. God, let all of them come. I don't know about him. And I close my eyes. The preacher gave an altar call, and I heard their chairs moving and people coming forward. And guess who come and stood right in front of me? The 6'11 guy. I said, God, you know, when you're in a situation, either you run away or you embrace what God is doing. And if you embrace, I tell you, God, what God is doing, you're embracing the grace of God. An embrace of grace, I call it. He stood there. Nobody would pray for him. It seemed like God said, this is yours. Don't ever reject the wound, the pouring of the Holy Spirit. When God says to do something, pray for somebody, talk to somebody. When you go to Kroger's Fiesta and you see the lady at the register and she's so sad looking, I dare you to go give her a hug. Says, in the name of Jesus, you're going to have a good day. This is what's wrong with us Christians. We're so inhibited. I used to work for the light company, you know. The light company, you know, we have the power and all this stuff. And all that, but you see, we're become so insulated in the church, like the wires. We have insulation, but we're isolated sometimes. You cannot be isolated from the public, even though you're insulated by the power of God in you. So this man stood in front of me, and I said, okay, God, I got down probably to this height because he was pretty tall, you know, and so I can see him face to face. Yes, I'm just a dime among nickels, okay? So he stood there, tears coming down his eyes, and I could smell his breath. I could see his countenance. God told me, hug him. I reached over, he reached over to me at the edge of the steps, and I hugged him. Yeah, he didn't smell like me. He didn't look like me. He didn't even talk like me. But when I hugged him, I just felt the presence of God. And we hugged for I don't know how long. And he cried and cried. And I say, by the power of the Holy Spirit, these little eyes begin to cry too. Why was I crying? Because there was a man that needed Jesus. Got away from him, and we cried, we talked. I gave him a Bible. I said, God bless you, brother. I love you. He walked away. You know how God works things out most of the time. 6 months later, preachers say, hey, Joe, why don't you take testimonies, ask people to testify. Anybody here wants to thank Jesus for something? Yeah, I want to thank you. And this guy in the back, he stood up. He had a vest, a three-piece suit and tie. And he says, you remember me? I said, no, I don't know you, sir. Yeah, you remember me. I don't remember you. Can I come forward? I said, can he come? He said, yeah. Yes, you remember me? I said, no, I don't. You prayed for me 6 months ago. I'm going to Lakewood. I'm back with my family. I'm going to Lakewood Church. I'm back with my family, and I'm reading my Bible now. I said, so you are the same person. He stopped me and said, no, I'm not the same. You never know who you're going to touch. So Jesus has touched this leprous man. So here's another one. So Jesus walking around, three ex-fishermen and one leper. Who's next? Remember, he's collected. Man, this group here don't look like most of the kingdom of God. See, sometimes we think that Jesus came together, big preachers and theologians. No, Jesus was an ordinary man touching ordinary people. So Jesus walking around, three ex-fishermen and one leper. So who's next? Again, in verse 23 and 26, and you can put it out there. Okay, so who is next? Here, the story of a man, let me fill you in, that was born paralyzed. And before the scriptures, the Bible says that there was a man who was paralyzed, and these three brothers, three men, they picked him up and took him to a house because they knew Jesus was going to be there. And they said, if we can take him to Jesus, Jesus will heal him. He will never be paralyzed anymore. You know the story. You heard the story. They could not get to the door because people was blocking the entrance, so the window. So they climb up the roof, and they made a hole on top of the house, and they lower this man to the feet of Jesus. When you and I really made up our minds to do something for the kingdom of God, you're going to become innovative. You're going to do something. This man lowered this paralyzed man at the feet of Jesus. And the Bible says on verse 23, Jesus speaking to the Pharisees, because he says, man, your sins are forgiven. Jesus says, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, rise up and walk? Verse 24. But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, arise, take up your bed, and go to your house. Now, here's again. Another person that Jesus talked, gathering people for the kingdom. He's got three ex-fishermen, one ex-leper, and one ex-paralyzed person. And he's still looking around. Oh, I'm telling you about God. When God set his mind to look for somebody, Jesus goes about looking for people in places that you never thought he looked at. And then bring us to verse 27 or Matthew. Luke 5:27. Immediately, he rose up before them, took up his head laying on, and departed to his own house, glorifying God. The leper began to control what is controlling him. He used to lay down on the mat. Can you see the leper walking out, controlling what was controlling him? Because of Jesus. Let's go back to the original scripture. On chapter 5 and verse 27, go back to Levi. After these things, he went out and saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax office, and he said unto him, follow him. Now, if I'm there, I said, Jesus, you got three ex-fishermen, you got one ex-leper, one ex-paralytic, not a tax collector. Come on, Jesus. Not a tax man. They're the ones that rip off people. See, tax collectors were some of the most hated people of those days because they oppressed the people. They will get money from the people, give some to Rome, and some they keep to themselves. So Levi is sitting there among his fellow tax collectors, doing what he always did, collect and oppress people. He didn't care about his reputation. Levi didn't care what they talk about him. All he cared about was about his money, the interest was money. He didn't care about his family, friends. He was a tax collector. He could get money however he could attain it. Everybody saw a tax collector, but Jesus saw a collector of souls. Levi, you shall be called Matthew, which means the gift of God. The tax collector became a gift of God unto his own people. You see, Levi, I believe, you know, when we give names to our children, it's for a reason. I mean, you name for whatever. But in Christianity in those days, if you name somebody Levi, I believe their parents says, we come from the Levi tribe, the tribe of the Levites. The Levites were the go between God and the people. The Levites were the priests of the day. So I can see mom and dad say, let's call him Levi, with the hope that someday he'll be a priest. He'll be a preacher. He'll be somebody that works in the kingdom of God. And happens that Levi twisted all around because of greed, and he went and became a collector of money. So Levi himself, the one that was supposed to be, according to their parents' wishes or hopes, to be somebody working in the temple, he became a tax collector, hated by men. They were looked as dishonest, oppressor of the poor. Low life Levi and his buddies were the lowest of the lowest of the day. But again, while people saw Levi, Jesus saw Matthew, a writer, an evangelist, a collector of people, of souls, because he was the gift of God. That's what Levi means. So this rip-off artist became a gift of God to his people. Follow me, Jesus says to Levi. Now Levi is secure and he's straight. He's got money every which way. Follow me. If I'm Levi, I'm thinking, what is it for me if I follow him? He didn't have an interview. If you follow me, you're going to get this and benefits. And no, he just said, follow me. So Levi is saying, what do I get if I follow Jesus? I'll tell you what. If you follow Jesus, I'll just show you one thing you get. You get Jesus. If you follow Jesus, you might first say, but you get Jesus. Jesus, the lover of your soul. Jesus, the one that died on the cross. Jesus, just what you get. That's what we need to, by the grace of God, say, God, let me fall again in love with Jesus. Sometimes I feel that the love in the church is growing cold toward Jesus. We love other things. We love everything else except Jesus. So Levi, he didn't ask what is in it for me. He decided, he dropped everything and began to follow Jesus because that's what he wanted to follow. He wanted to follow somebody other than himself. Sometimes we follow ourselves, but here he got up and began to follow him. And I think of this, when it says, follow me, the Bible says, Levi got up and began to follow him. You cannot follow sitting down. You cannot follow sitting down. He got up and began to follow Jesus. And I understand, again, let's understand about Levi. Levi, like he was from the Levites, you know, the name Levi meant something to the religious atmosphere of those days. Like I said, they were the priests where God's go between. Levi was meant to be the human face of a loving God. He was to bring people under the influence of God. But because of his greed and disobedience, everything got twisted around. As a tax collector, Levi became Rome's go-between. He was the Jewish face of an oppressing empire. He had become the opposite of what God intended him to become. But still, Jesus went looking for him. Oh, I'm not what I'm supposed to be. But God is still looking for you. Oh, I haven't attained. I haven't. But God is still looking for you. Levi is an example, somebody that was hated by society, and Jesus came to him, and he left all those things, got up and followed him. Sometimes when this God speaks a now word, we must be willing to give a now answer. Don't think about it. When the Holy Spirit reveals something unto you, grab it and put it into your spirit. Don't say, I'm going to go home and analyze it. I'm going to look at the encyclopedia. No, you grab it. A now word is a now answer for you and for me. Because God speaks now, in our word. So Peter, like I said, Levi began to follow Jesus. Follow me, he says. Nothing had made Levi leave his trade. Nothing. I'm sure mom and daddy were telling Levi, why are you doing that? We want you to be a preacher. I'm okay, I'm making money. Mom and daddy or the friends, come on, leave that. It's not good for you. Oh, that's okay. I'm going to make it. And sometimes we go in life trying to ask people, come on, get off of that trade. Get off of that thing. Get off of that habit. Get off of that thing you're doing. Come on. That's what I want to do now. But I tell you what, if your son and your daughter, your husband or your wife or a relative you know is doing something that you know is not good for them, pray for them. Let the Holy Spirit come and grab him and say, God, I'm going to love you because I know you love me back. It's not up to us to change people. It's up to the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what Paul said. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ because it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. There's a power in the gospel to change people. We can't change people, but we can bring the message of hope, of grace to people, so change will happen in people. So here's, Levi would not leave the trade for anything. But when Jesus said, follow me, I believe Levi had everything, but there was something missing. Somebody that will accept him the way he was. Somebody that will say, I love you, Levi, I know you're doing wrong. Follow me. See, when God speaks to your heart and my heart about following him, we're going to put everything down and say, God, I'm going to follow you. And Levi made up his mind because he wanted to be with Jesus. We can be with many people. We can be with many groups. But the ultimate thing, when everything falls by the wayside, Jesus is who we want. Follow me. Can you hear Levi's friends? He's been with these guys from a long time. Hey, Levi, how come you're standing up? I'm going to follow him. But you don't know nothing about him. Oh, he loves me. Come on, Levi. We've been hanging around together. We're buddies. Come on, you're going to leave us, Levi? I'm sorry, but he loves me the way I am. Come on, Levi, don't leave us. We know each other. We hang around together. I'm sorry, but I got to follow him because he picked me from all of us and he loves me. How do you know he loves you, Levi? Because he said, follow me. Nobody told me that before. Everybody's trying to change me. Everybody says, change your habits, change your ways, change your way of life. But he says, just follow me. I believe Levi sensed love coming out of Jesus. I'm sorry. Are you sure, Levi? I'm sorry, guys. You're my buddies. We've been together this for a long time. But I gotta go. I gotta go. So Levi followed Jesus. And the next scripture says, in verse 29, Then Levi hosted a great banquet in his own house, and there were a great number of tax collectors and others who sat down with them, and others that sat down with them. He threw a big banquet. See, here is Levi sitting at the table, collecting taxes for his own gain. He was sitting at the table, the Bible says, at the booth or table of collecting. He's the same Levi. Once he met Jesus, I'm telling you something. Once grace happens in you, once grace happens in you, you cannot help it, but generosity will follow. You no longer are the same. You begin to be generous with people you don't even know. Once grace happens in your life, you begin to love the unlovable. You begin to give. You begin to pray. You are a different person because grace has come to your house. And Peter, or Levi, in this case, Levi, Peter, he says, follow me, Matthew, I'm sorry. He followed him, and generosity happened. And Matthew wanted to celebrate his newfound life. I guess I can say it. When my birthday comes, my wife, my son said, hey, what do you want for your birthday, Dad? And what do you want for the birthday? That's okay. I don't want nothing. It's just another day. Deep inside, I say, man, I want a big party. I want a trip to the Bahamas. I want a big steak. But we don't say that. Why are we men like that? What can we be yourself? Hey, son, hey, mama, hey, daddy, what do you want for that? I'll tell you what I want for my birthday. I want a party with party hats, whistles, the whole thing. We don't say that because we're so respectable. That's okay. It's just another day in the calendar. Deep inside, you know that you want somebody to say happy birthday to you. Levi, I believe in a way he was celebrating his new birth. He says, I'm going to throw a party. Levi is going to cost you money. I got money. I believe if Levi lived in Houston, I believe he rented the Astrodome. Harris County, is that empty? Yes, I want to rent it because I want to throw a big banquet, a big party, he says. And he said he decided to throw a big banquet because she wanted to celebrate his newfound life in Christ Jesus. See, let me say this. Levi knew about God. You and I know about God. See, Levi knew about God, but next to the knowledge of knowing about God, the knowledge of his grace and who you are is what really makes a difference. You can know about God, but don't know God. But once you know God through Jesus Christ and his grace, something happened internally. Then all of a sudden, you're no longer the same person because you know about God and you know God. Well, God knows me. People say, yeah, he knows you, but do you know him? That's the difference. I never met President Obama. I know him, but I haven't met him. I know about Craig Biggio, big day today, Pastor Don. I never met Craig Biggio. You'll say, he's speaking in tongues, Biggio. Follow the sports once in a while. Come on, get down. So I never met Craig Biggio, but I know about him. See, you can know about somebody. You can read about somebody. You even can follow them in the Twitter and face, my face, your space, or whatever you call it, and you know about somebody. But if you never met the somebody, you don't really know the somebody. Well, they know me. Yeah, they know you, but come on. I'm sorry. Can I just be myself, sister? I'm not into this Facebook, just face, my face, and all this stuff. That's okay. I'm not against that stuff, okay? I love it. I think technology is awesome. But I'm sorry. I have a granddaughter. She got so many friends. I said, you got so many friends? How many? Oh, about 75 friends. I said, yeah. Who are they? And she named them all. I said, wow. When did you meet them? On my face, space, whatever, Facebook thing. I said, girl, They're not really your friends. You don't know what is at the other end of the line. When you met them, when you hug them, when you shake their hand, when you embrace them, they are your real friends. I'm not against technology. Understand what I'm saying. But anyway, forget the technology. So here, next to the knowledge of God, the knowledge of His grace is what really matters. So Matthew threw a party with a purpose. When was the last time you threw a party on your own house, inviting somebody that didn't look like you, think like you, or believe like you? When was the last time? Now, the Bible said there was a large crowd of tax collectors and others who were guests. Who were the others? I asked God, who were the others? And I found out the others, it was you, it was you, it was me. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as receive him and believe in him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God. Others, whosoever will. So here, I was religious. I had all those things, but I didn't have a relationship. You know, a lot of us here, we can say honestly that we had religion, but we never had a relationship with God until he came down where we were. You know, I said this because it's in the Bible. You were not born righteous. You were not born righteous. You know, Paul says in Romans and Corinthians that we became the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And Romans says, has sin came through one man? Through one man, Christ, many are become righteous. You become righteous. Once the revelation comes to your spirit that you are the son, the daughter of the most living God, then you can walk with your chest popped up. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But if I didn't get the revelation, I'm still in a religious mode. So Matthew opened his house. He had a big party. I'm going to just go on the line right quick. He threw a big party for Jesus, and Jesus was there. Can you see Jesus? People say, don't talk loud, but Jesus was fully God, but he was fully man. He ate, he slept, he got tired just like you and I. Can you see Jesus at the table with all this bunch of nobodies? And Jesus sat down at the table. I can see Jesus. The children come up and sit on his lap and keep glugging and talking, and another comes. And the religious folk, what is he doing hanging around with those people? Jesus said, I came for those that knew they were sinners, outsiders. I didn't come for those that they thought they were righteous. So Jesus sitting at the table. What table? Levi. Jesus finally sitting at the table collecting taxes. Something happened in Levi's life that he decided to set a table for the people. The same Levi that was ripping off over the table all the time. He's a servant unto the multitudes out of his own pocket. Grace and action. Can you see Jesus at another table? And people looking at him, is he going to eat barbecue like us? Can you give me the gravy over here? Jesus says. How about some bread? How about some rolls over here? Me and the disciples been all over. We're hungry. Come on. Jesus was fully human. And he was fully God. He could relate to you. Now, he sat at the table with the people, with common, ordinary people. I really can see Jesus. Levi over there, can you bring me an extra tea of my glass? Yes, he could relate to you and me because he's the only person. They understand us just the way we are. So Jesus is at the table, a table of grace. A table of grace. We grace people. I believe every Christian is a grace people because everything comes by grace. grace people? From time to time, can we invite somebody to a table and just welcome them and make them feel at home? Jesus did. And he sat there and ate with them, laughed with them. He don't say nothing, but I believe they had music at the time. Every time they got together in fellowship, there was such an atmosphere of happiness, eating all the stuff, wiping your face from the gravy and passing the biscuits, and music was playing. A happy occasion because Jesus had come to the house and the table was there for everybody to enjoy it. Let me say this. It is not what you do as a Christian. It is not what you do as a Christian that defines who you are. It is who you are that determines what you do. It is not what you do as a Christian that defines who you are. It is who you are that determines what you do. A table of grace, a table of hope, a table of mercy.